My name is Chris Collier. I'm the executive director of Renew Theaters, and I want to thank you for joining us tonight for this deep focus seminar discussion of Citizen Kane. This is the first of three programs in which we're very thrilled to have Andrew Douglas from Bryn Mawr Film Institute guiding us through these, looking at expanding your cinematic vocabulary. So it's not just talking about the films like we've been doing with Hannah, although I know we'll do that for sure, but really looking at the techniques in terms of how the films are made. And I'm really excited to have Andrew here with us to guide us through these three films. Deep Focus is a virtual seminar series that allows us to bring in speakers from all over the United States and allows us to come together no matter where we're from. One of the challenges, I think, of having just the discussions at the theater is that they are geographically limited, but we're able to welcome patrons from each of the four theaters that Renew operates, and hopefully some patrons from Bryn Mawr who know Andrew, and then also our partner theater, the Majestic Theater in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. So wherever you're joining us, thanks for tuning in, and I look forward to a great discussion. This program is brought to you by the VESTA Fund, and really appreciate their grant that allowed us to put this together and allows us to discuss film. Just quickly, as I mentioned, there are two other films in this series, and they are The Birds, which will be on Tuesday, October 25th, and Strangers on a Train, which will be on Monday, November 7th. So make sure to join all three, because I believe each of these will be building on each other, and you'll walk away with an incredible new skill set and ways to recognize films. But that's not the only set of Deep Focus films we have going this fall. We have a wonderful series on Black independent film, and the next discussion will be Ganja and Hess, and that'll be on Tuesday 11th next week. And that film is playing at a couple of our theaters right now. So if you want to see that on the big screen, you can. And there's some other wonderful films in that series. And Hannah Jack's classic Hollywood series continues with the Halloween Perfect title, The Cat People, on Tuesday the 18th. You can find more information about all of the upcoming films and when they might be playing at the theaters at deepfocus.film. But for now, glad you're here. A couple Zoom protocols. Would invite everyone, if you can, to turn on your camera. It makes it feel like we're all in the room together, even though we're in different places. It's much nicer to see everyone's faces and feel like we're in a circle together. I'm gonna turn things over to Andrew in a second, and he'll be doing a brief primer and an intro. And during that period, we ask that everyone remain on mute, and then we'll open it up to conversation in a little bit. And I will moderate that Q&A. If you'd like to use the raise hand feature, I'll call on people, and hopefully that will keep things orderly to start. And then we can open it up, just jump in and talk as we get a little more into the conversation. The only other note is that the chat function in Zoom is enabled, and would encourage you all to take good use of that. I find that there's often really good sidebar conversation going on, a lot of good IMDb sleuthing that comes up. And I'll make sure to monitor that as well and bring in any interesting facts or conversation into the main thread. All right, so it is now my pleasure to turn things over to Andrew Douglas, who is the founding director of the educational program at Bryn Mawr Film Institute, a program which we at Renew very much admire. And I strongly recommend that if anyone here likes these programs in terms of discussion, that you check out the programs at Bryn Mawr. They go in much more depth and have a wide range of speakers and professors leading you through a range of topics. So it's a real wealth of information over there. So you can find, I'll throw a link to their website in the chat. But Andrew started that program back in 2005, only 4 months after Bryn Mawr's opening. and has been there for a while, leading that program and growing it. And recently in 2022, just this year, he became deputy director of the Bryn Mawr Film Institute, further expanding his responsibilities, which I think is incredibly well-deserved. Andrew earned his BA from Brandeis University, where he majored in American Studies and completed the Film Studies and Journalism program. He has worked as a film critic and also earned his MA in Communication Studies at UNC Chapel Hill. He then received his PhD from Northwestern University, where his focus was on American film history, film theory, and genre theory. And we are thrilled to have Andrew here for these three films to expand our cinematic vocabulary. So without further ado, Andrew, the floor is yours.
Thanks so much, Chris, for that lovely introduction and for inviting me to be part of this series. I think it's wonderful the range of topics you all are covering in Deep Focus. And I am glad to be able to bring my experience teaching a course at BMFI called The Language of Film, a little bit of that experience to this series we're doing to truly help people expand their cinematic vocabularies. I'll do today what I plan to do for the other sessions as well, which is basically look at the film that you all have seen and that we're going to discuss more broadly in a little while. Look at some of the techniques that are used in that film, examples of filmmaking techniques within that movie, not necessarily because every one of them is somehow exceptional, meaning really extraordinary, superlative, but they're all very strong examples of the given techniques that are being used. And we might as well learn about those techniques by using a film, a text that we all have just recently reacquainted ourselves with. So today's terminology, some of the terms we're going to and techniques we're going to be looking at, they all have to do with cinematography, which has to do with everything related to the camera in making a motion picture. So that includes everything from what type of camera, whether how that camera moves, whether that camera moves, what format that camera is filming, whether that is photochemical film or digital, what the aspect ratio is, which is the ratio of the width of the frame to the height of the frame. We've all seen movies with those different shaped frames. That's what that is. And it also includes lighting, not so much lighting as it is visible to you in a scene in terms of shadow and lighter spots and contrast. That's more an element of mise-en-scène, which we'll get to when we talk about Strangers on a Train. But in terms of lighting the set, lighting it to create a look, but more importantly, from a cinematography point of view, lighting it to be able to capture, create and capture the images that the filmmakers want to create and capture. And the person who is sort of the department head in charge of all things camera is known as the director of photography or the cinematographer. And that person is sometimes called the cameraman, colloquially, or the camera operator, although not all cinematographers operate their own cameras. And very often there are multiple cameras going, so they're certainly not operating every camera. But they're sort of the creative director of the use of photography within the film. And Citizen Kane is a wonderful example to use to study this. And that's really for two main reasons. One is that, as many of you know, it was made by a first-time filmmaker, Orson Welles. And it wasn't just, he wasn't just any first-time filmmaker. He was a first-time filmmaker of whom there were big expectations and who expected big things from himself and who was not modest or shy or any sort of shrinking violet, and took the opportunity to jump into a new medium to its fullest. And one of the ways he did that is by working with arguably the best, if not the best, then certainly one of the top handful of cinematographers working in Hollywood at that time, Greg Toland. And I'm just going to share my screen here. So we're going to have some slides. And what Tolan did was seek out Welles and decide to that he wanted to work with him. And the reason he did that, he stated, as Welles would later recall, because Welles was so new to cinema, he didn't know what couldn't be done. Tolan had recently won an Oscar for his photography in Wuthering Heights. He also shot The Grapes of Wrath, Long Voyage Home. He would go on to shoot The Best Years of Our Lives. His life, unfortunately, was cut short in the mid-1940s. But he was an exceptional cinematographer, and a lot of people give Tolan credit for the look of Citizen Kane. And this is an age-old debate that will go on long after we end this meeting. What is clear is that Welles felt that Tolan was the premier cinematographer of his time, that he learned a tremendous amount from him, and that he couldn't have created Citizen Kane without him. And that is obvious in the closing credits of the film, as you can see on your screen, Welles shared his credit card with Tolan. Welles was not known to be generous with credit. Many of you probably know he was pretty stingy with the credit for his co-screenwriter, Herman Mankiewicz. But he recognized that Tolan made a tremendous contribution to the film, and he gave him really the highest level of credit I think Welles was probably capable of giving. It's also said that Welles, you know, though he certainly had a healthy ego, knew that he didn't know how to make movies. And that was one of the things that made Tolan want to work with him. And the story goes that before they filmed a frame of Citizen Kane, they watched Stagecoach. Apparently they watched Stagecoach dozens of times to begin to give Welles the sort of film language primer that we're going to start, I hope, to give you all here. Although certainly not on the same level, because I am no Greg Tolan. So when we talk about cinematography, we're talking about everything related to the camera. And I think it's important here to think about how film techniques are used more broadly. Film is a lot of things. It is a form of communication. It is an art form, and it's a historical document. In its capacity as a form of education, there's the sender. The filmmakers are putting something up on the screen, and they're hoping that we, the receivers of what they're communicating, pick up on it. And this only works because we're speaking the same language. It only works if we're speaking the same language. The language of film isn't as precise a language as something like the English I'm speaking now is. And so sometimes things don't land right. Sometimes filmmakers are trying to suggest one thing and people don't pick up on it. There's a lot of room for error there, but when it works, because the filmmakers and the audience are aware that the techniques that the filmmakers are using, that the choices they're making have a value and a language and a sort of narrative or communicative currency, when everyone's on the same page about that, things work out really well. And so what I want to do over the next little while before we get to our broader discussion of the movie as a whole is look at some examples of relatively simple techniques in Citizen Kane, and then move to one scene in particular that uses a very ambitious technique known as deep focus, as it turns out. That for which Tolan was famous and that this film would become famous for as well. But not just show it to you as an example, but do as I hope to with these other images, give you a sense of how they're trying to sort of communicate to us. Because again, there's a screenplay, and the screenplay tells us what is happening in the film, what is to be seen broadly, but how something is filmed, there's a wide latitude open to a filmmaker in terms of how something appears. And that's something to keep in mind when you're watching a film, to say to yourself, well, why did they show us this moment? Why did they depict this moment this way? Why did they use this technique here? So for example, here's an example of a high angle shot. One of the ways we refer to shots, the component elements of cinematography, is from their angle. Most of the time we don't talk about the angle, we're talking about a shot that is straight on. But when a shot is from on high looking down, that's a high angle shot. And here's an example of one from Citizen Kane. And we can imagine why this moment in the film was shot using a high angle shot. I would suggest that it's done because this is shortly before Getty's sort of drops the hammer about, or drops the bombshell, I should say, of Kane's affair. And so whether you want to think of it as Getty's has the upper hand, or he's sort of looking down on the man whose political aspirations he's going to crush or what have you, we can imagine how filming this moment this way was added to the meaning that was being conveyed by Welles and Tolan. Here's another high angle shot. This is when Kane is watching Susan Alexander's performance, as we know, that she wasn't really too keen on doing, and a performance that isn't going well, and a performance that isn't pleasing him. And one of the things that strikes me during this portion of the film is how uncomfortable it is, how cringy it is, basically, how we feel for Susan, how even to an extent you feel for Kane, and the sense of how he has tried to control her career and her life, I think is made very evident, not just by the fact that this is a high angle shot with him in the foreground and he looms so largely and she looks so small, almost like a sort of, you know, an ant under a magnifying glass that he's staring at. There's a power difference here that the choice of the high angle shot helps to underscore. The opposite of a high angle shot is a low angle shot. And this is used to communicate different things typically, although there can be some overlap. And if any of you has seen any images from production stills from the making of Citizen Kane, or seen any of the movies that have as an element of them the making of Citizen Kane, you undoubtedly saw where they were breaking through the floor of the soundstage and digging holes so they could put cameras right at floor level or even below to shoot up like this. The idea that they had to put ceilings on all of the sets undoubtedly bothered many people involved with the production. That was certainly far from standard operating procedure. It also would make lighting more challenging, a challenge that Tolan probably appreciated. But here you can see a shot that very often a low angle shot is used to make someone seem more imposing, to make them seem larger. We don't really get that sense here. I don't particularly get that sense here. And if we recall when this is in the movie, that meaning isn't really there. I think this is a low angle shot, probably because of the ceiling that somehow makes the subject, Kane, seem small, smaller than we typically see him depicted in the film. And I think that makes more sense given where we are in the movie. Here's another low angle shot. And of course, this is one of the confrontations between Jedediah and Kane, and questions of integrity and promises made, and power struggle and things like that come to the fore. And again, I think that this low angle shot looking up at the two of them, again, makes them seem like relatively small players in a much larger drama. And that's, it's sort of funny to think about Kane being a small player in the drama of his own life, but that's, I think, a recurrent sort of theme in this movie, and we'll get to another example of it later on. So if we talk about the angle of the camera, we also want to talk about the perceived camera distance, right? And when the camera is placed far away from the object it is intending to show us, that is called a long shot, because there's a long distance between the camera and the object. And here is an example of a long shot from later in the film. This is after he's busted up Susan Alexander's room after she's announced that she's leaving. And we have seen him, the character, lose control in a way that we hadn't typically seen. We had seen the character suffer a loss. I think because of this film being about what it's about, it's less an emotional loss and more a loss of control, his inability to control what Susan's going to do any longer, his inability to make her stay. And this long shot, particularly through the open door, under all the arches and sort of in these various layers of prosceniums, served to make Kane seem very small and indeed very powerless. And I think you can start to see here part of, and for that matter, you can see from in the other images as well, the influence of Welles's career in the theater. That was where Welles first really came to note. Well, I guess you first came to note with War of the Worlds in the Mercury Theater radio show. But he really developed quite a reputation as a stage director in New York City, something he did while he was working on various radio shows, including the Mercury Theater radio show. He was the voice of the Shadow on that radio show in the 1930s. And he had at least one, sometimes multiple stage productions going on. Some of them very sort of bold and avant-garde, including an all-black Macbeth that he was working on in New York City as well. And you can see in these low angle shots, the influence of the theater. We've all been to see major stage productions, and typically we are seated at least in the main section of the theater. We're very often below where the action is occurring. And there's very much a sense of the set containing the actors on the stage. So I think that influence is part of why he likes these low angle shots so much. But here, he also has the depth of the stage, how far back it goes. And he wants to be able to use that full range of space. And that's something that comes through in long shots like this. Now, something that he couldn't use or couldn't take from the stage or couldn't make happen on the stage is the close-up. Here's the famous close-up from the beginning of the film. And it's quite an extreme close-up. We think of a close-up basically usually as someone's face filling the screen, not someone's mustache and lips filling the screen. You know, he's obviously doing this to emphasize the importance of the word that these lips are going to utter. And that's something to think about, that the larger something appears on screen, the more important, symbolically more important it is, if not narratively more important. And so just as Kane here is feeling very insignificant, we are being introduced to this Titan that none of us really knows at the start of the film, if we can imagine a time when we hadn't seen the film or heard of it before. It's being strongly suggested to us just how important this man's last words must be. And this brings us to the technique that Toland is probably best known for, and the one that, whether he knew it or not, is probably the biggest reason that Welles was happy to work with him. Depth of field is the term for the distance in front of the camera that is in sort of ideally crisp focus, but certainly serviceable focus. We are conditioned to pay attention to the things that are in focus and pay little or no attention to the things that are out of focus. And the standard approach to making, to shooting Hollywood films at this time was to have relatively short depths of field, to have the object or the character that was important in a shot be in focus, and the things behind him or her or in front of him or her not in focus because they didn't matter. And this was because, this was for a couple of reasons. One, it was easier in order to have a large range in front of the camera in focus, you need a lot of light, or you need faster film, which is faster at sort of absorbing the light. And that is, for a long time, that was tough for Hollywood to do, certainly tough for Hollywood to do on a schedule and on a budget. And so that's one reason. The other reason, and this is just one of the many rules or traditions that Kane broke and is part of the reason why it is held in such esteem. Part of the reason is having only one thing or one character in focus in a shot makes it very easy for the audience to know what's important and what to pay attention to. And while we all appreciate movies that challenge us and movies that are not strictly or always conventional, the sort of modus operandi of Hollywood at the time was to really sort of spoon feed things to the audience. There was no interest in being bold or different or iconoclastic in filmmaking. Hollywood filmmaking was in an industry, and standardization was what the industry wanted. There were filmmakers, obviously, who worked against that and did their own thing and were able to sort of bring in their own choices that went against that tradition or that sort of industrial kind of priority. But by and large, they wanted things to be simple and easy and fast and inexpensive and able to be understood by anyone who might be watching the movie. But when you have a long depth of field like this, and you have lots of things to look at, some very striking things. Her sparkly dress, the enormous puzzle in front of her, the biggest fireplace I've ever seen, and the title character standing in it. There's a lot for us to look at and a lot for us to take in. And now that's what Welles wants, and that's what Toland wants. But that's one of the things that makes this film relatively unconventional. And so here's an example of a pretty considerable depth of field. And this is what Toland would come to be known for. And he's pushing this envelope in his other films as well. He does it in Long Voyage Home, and he would do it again in Best Days of Our Lives. Here's another example of that significant depth of field where we can see clearly the things in the foreground closest to the camera, but we can also see Kane all the way in the back there. And we can imagine the symbolic value of being able to have a shot like this, whether it is to see how small he looks in the doorway, whether it is to see these statues of what look like Egyptian gods staring at him, perhaps judging him. There's virtue in having this whole canvas sort of open to Welles and Toland and everyone else to paint with, and open to us to perceive and try to interpret. Okay, so what I would like to do now, I'm going to stop the share for a second. I just did a heck of a lot of talking. And I wanted to know if anybody had any questions before I go on to the clip and the sort of last major cinematography point.
Yes, Bob.
Hey, Andrew, I thought that was really great. How much of the depth of field stuff is due to advances in lens technology or film, and how much of it is really the Tolan's idea about what he wanted to show?
Well, those sort of really go hand in hand, because I mean, he wants to push the envelope, and I mean, many of the things on a camera, on a Hollywood camera, I'm sorry, on a motion picture camera during this time in particular, were invented or altered by the camera operators or the director of photography. And that includes lenses. A lot of these cinematographers, particularly back in that era, but a number today, really think of themselves as artisans, as craftspeople, much more so than they would think of themselves as artists. That you'll hear that in interview after interview with guys like Toland or James Wong Howe or Russell Meddy. It's really sort of, you know, it's hard to answer. It's almost a chicken and egg question, but I mean, I think the best answer, the answer that's most often true, is that a cinematographer wanted to push the envelope. So they worked on the lens and they talked to the, Kodak, the company's making the film stock, and said, here's what we need, here's what I need. So they couldn't do it without those advancements and without changes to lights, that being, which lights were available and how those lights were powered and things like that. But those advancements were probably being made in most cases because there were cinematographers pushing them to make them.
Thank you.
Okay, well, if there aren't any other questions about that first bit, I'll go on to the clip. I guess what I'll say is I'm going to show you the scene where Thatcher first comes to meet young Charles and take him off to live his life and see the world. And I want you to watch this and appreciate what the depth of field, what the deep focus that Tolan is able to create allows Welles to do in terms of the way the characters move and interact as the scene goes on. And what I hope to do is, I'll show you this, ask for some observations, and then look at a few stills from it, hopefully, and sort of fill in the gaps to what I'm sure will be the great points you pick up on. So I'll get that clip going.
People seem to forget that I'm the boy's father.
It's going to be done exactly the way I've told Mr. Thatcher.
There ain't nothing wrong with Colorado. I don't see why we can't raise our own son just because we come into some money. If I want, I can go to court. A father has a right to. A boarder that beats his bill and leaves worthless stock behind. That property is just as much my property as anybody's, now that it's valuable. And if Fred Graves had any idea all this was going to happen, he'd have made out those certificates in both our names.
However, they were made out in Mrs. Kane's name.
He owed the money for the board to the both of us.
The bank's decision on all matters
concerning... I don't hold with signing my boy away to any bank as guardian.
I want you to stop all this nonsense.
The bank's decision on all matters concerning his education, his places of residence, and similar subjects is to be final.
The idea of a bank.
I want you to stop all this nonsense, Jim.
We will assume full management of the Colorado Lode, of which I repeat, Mrs. Kane, you are the sole owner.
Where do I sign, Mr. Thatcher?
Right here, Mrs. Kane.
Mary, I'm asking you for the last time. Anybody think I hadn't been a good husband?
The sum of $50,000 a year is to be paid to you and Mr. Kane as long as you both live, and thereafter to the survivor.
Well, let's hope it's all for the best.
It is.
Why I can't raise my own boy more than I can understand.
Go on, Mr. Thatcher.
Everything else, the principal as well as all monies earned, is to be administered by the bank in trust for your son, Charles Foster Kane, until he reaches his 25th birthday, at which time he is to come into complete possession.
Charles! Go on, Mr. Thatcher.
Well, it's almost five, Mrs. Kane. Don't you think I'd better meet the boy?
I've got his trunk all packed. I've had it packed for a week now.
Okay, so I'm wondering if anybody has any observations that they would like to share based on the sort of major portion of that scene, which is when Thatcher and Mrs. Kane are at the table and Mr. Kane is sort of toward the background. Is there anything that anybody picked up on that the depth of field allowed them to create and us to observe regarding the sort of underscoring aspects of the meaning of the scene?
Lorraine?
I saw basically initially you get the terrible image of them bargaining over her son and freezing the father out. I know later on that changes as the scene develops in the movie. And meanwhile, here's a little boy, and it's like they're just trading him as an object. At least that was my initial in real time impression when I was watching it. And then you get a better sense very, very quickly when they go outside and she has a conversation with the husband, father of the boy, and whatever may have seemed to have happened with them. But at this point, you know, it's the contrast is remarkable. Just the impersonal bargaining and cutting a deal, and you think she's just selling the kid for money.
I think that one of the, I think you make a good point, and particularly I think the point you made at the beginning of your comment that, you know, the depth of field allows us to sort of see the boy out the window, and the sound lets us hear him, but we sort of see him cavorting out there, and that is this sort of ongoing visual reminder of that the deal, the negotiation, their conversation they're having is about a person. And about right. A person whose future is being sort of determined by what's happening in there. And He's out there in the background, far away, flitting about like an afterthought. And he's an afterthought to them as well, It seems.
Yeah.
Any other comments?
Doug, I see your hand up.
Hi. Yeah. I was really interested in what you said about how deep focus allows a kind of freedom of the viewer in order to like see, you know, pick out different things to look at in the frame and have that that kind of autonomy. I don't really get a great sense of freedom in this movie. I think of, you know, Francois Truffaut, where he's just going to watch little Antoine walk down a block for a while, and it's just completely passive and you're free to look at just about anything in the screen. That's more autonomy to me. Here, I can't help but feel pressure to look. The view is guided very specifically along, even with that that initial shot. We start out looking at the little boy through the window. We don't realize it's a window at first until they pull back. And then you see the angle is off just slightly. You're looking at it, not the window, not head on, but off to the side so that the lines slant over onto the mother. And then it continues to pull back and incorporate in the bank manager. And then it pulls back even more and you get the father coming in. And then from there, you can see everything in perfectly clear focus, but there's a tension there. There's really no, I wouldn't call it freedom at all, because you get a sense of each one as they're speaking, you can see them in great clarity, but you're not allowed to really choose who to look at because it's they're each their own little polarized atom in that frame. So I see the deep focus technique as, in fact, restricting and focusing your attention on specific portions of the frame. There's not a lot of there's not a lot of laissez-faire going on in any of this movie. It is all composed very painterly to guide your eye through each frame.
Well, you're absolutely right. There's a lot of composition. You're absolutely right that, and I saw this come up in the chat. I mean, Welles comes from the theater and he is taking advantage of the whole stage, so to speak, that whole field in focus in front of the camera to compose things and place things as he wants. That being said, and the fact that the depth of field allows a lot of things to be in focus and gives us the potential to look at more things than we would have with a short depth of field, doesn't mean the film isn't urging us, nudging us, you might say forcing us to look at certain things. And certainly, I'm gonna share my screen again, put the slide up. Certainly here with Thatcher and Mrs. Kane in the foreground, that's who we are supposed to pay most attention to. But we have the freedom to watch the boy in the background, which we wouldn't have if there were short depth, if this weren't in deep focus. We have the freedom to watch the father and what he does, which we wouldn't have if this were in weren't in deep focus. And I think that I might have not chosen the best word, or we might have different conceptions of what I mean as freedom. I think giving you no indication what is worth looking at is not the same thing necessarily as a viewer having the potential. I should have said that, I guess, the potential instead of the freedom, the potential to see other things and to see what he or she wants to. But I'll give you an example. If this were not in deep focus, we would have Mrs. Kane and Thatcher in focus, and they would be the ones we would have no choice but to look at them and have them be the people, the characters we pay attention to in the scene. But because that's not true, there are things we can notice here, and we can see what I think is a much more thoughtful composition that the deep focus enables. So if you look here, you see the contract here, these white pieces of paper that are the contract that's going to determine, you know, the future for young Charles. And those are sort of visually aligned to this white rectangle outside in the snow, the view outside, which is where Kane actually is. They sort of occupy the center of the frame. So that connection we're able to pick up on that connection. The other thing we're able to see happen is watch, not just hear the father's position change, but watch his position change. So he's back by the window watching Charles when it starts. He comes closer. He stands sort of here in the middle ground, you know, while Thatcher's telling them about the conditions and the rules. And then he says, you know, that bit about who says I've been a bad father just because a boy comes into some money. He's really pressing his case. So he comes closer. And then he hears the part about the $50,000 a year. And he turns around and starts to retreat. And so this depth of field allows there to be a lot more going on visually that underscores the other thematic elements that are happening in the scene. And I think without that sort of big canvas, we wouldn't have these visual reinforcements of the more sort of core narrative and thematic elements of the film.
Cynthia?
Yes, I thought it was pretty interesting. I've seen this movie many, many times. And in that scene, I'm always focused on the mother. And I feel that having Charles in the background just kind of reminds you that he's the one on her mind and not her husband and what he wants to happen.
Yeah, I mean, they could have done this. I mean, that's the thing you want to think about. You want to think about the choices available to the filmmakers, right? It would be extremely easy. And none of us would have thought twice if we'd seen this movie and there had been no sign of Charles in this scene, right? Because grownups, particularly in that era, grownups talk about stuff like this away from the kids all the time. But so the fact that he's there, it's meant to suggest that, you know, to add a poignancy, to add a level of sort of, you know, to confirm the importance of this moment and how it is a key sort of inflection point in the trajectory that we've already sort of seen the results of, at least some of the results of.
Kevin?
Yeah, hey, what I have to say is pretty simple. What I see is a kid playing outside while he's also outside of the negotiations that determine or that will determine his fate.
Yeah. No, it is. I think that's of symbolic importance, right? I mean, I think you said much more succinctly and plainly what I was trying to say. But I think you're right. And that's something this technique allows to happen, right? Could you have had some other way of conveying that he was playing outside? Probably. You could have had sound, although that would have seemed, people would have wondered if that was a mistake, if they were hearing him but not seeing him, probably. But you're absolutely right. He's, you know, he might be on someone's mind a little bit, but he's certainly not in the room, as they say, having an impact on the events that are going to shape his life. Absolutely.
Ann and Wynn, I think I saw a hand up at one point.
Just really to underscore and agree with what Kevin just observed. For me, it was just so poignant having Charles in the frame, and then he falls down, so he disappears. And you know, it's such great foreshadowing of what's really going to be happening. And he's just disappearing from his parents' lives. Just, you know, we see it in real time, and we know what's going to happen. So it's. I hadn't really focused on that shot before, so thanks for calling our attention to it.
Well, that's sort of those are the points I wanted to cover about cinematography. I'm happy to open this up to a discussion of the film more broadly. There's certainly a lot of interesting facets to it.
Lorraine?
Yeah, one of the things that struck me is that even though all the great techniques that you guys were going through, they're wonderful. And so I feel like there's a lot in the film. But in real time watching the film, I didn't feel emotionally connected to Kane himself. I didn't really care what happened to him. I was just watching a story about it and like, wow, you know, this happens. But I didn't feel like, you know, oh, I hope he gets over this or, oh my God. So he's not a likable person, I guess. And there was not that emotional connection that a lot of times a viewer, you know, has. I mean, in contrast to, let's say, Casablanca, which, you know, you're very invested in the characters there.
Well, I think that's a, I mean, that's an interesting point of comparison, right? I mean, they're sort of, they're pretty much peer films, right? And they come out of the same industry, certainly. But one of the things I think that makes, that made Kane so, the movie, so challenging and controversial in its time, you know, obviously the subject matter has a lot to do with it. The fact that at this point in time, you just didn't take on one of the most, you know, you didn't make a film that had an unflattering portrayal of one of the most powerful people in the country. Just Hollywood wasn't in that business. Oliver Stone wouldn't be born for a few years. The other thing is, has to do with the structure of the film. And this is why, I mean, this is why I think this film, you know, is held in the esteem that it is and has been for so long, is it breaks so many rules but still works. And one of the rules it breaks, and I think this goes directly to the sort of the issue you have, Lorraine, is that the main character is not the protagonist, right? I mean, Kane's done when the movie starts.
Yeah.
And the protagonist really is that reporter who we never pretty much get to see.
Yes.
And he's the one who's sort of driving the story forward in a way. Mm. And so you talk about identification and likability. There are a lot of movies we see, not a lot, there are a number of movies we see where we find a way to identify with a character we don't like. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we come to like a character we know isn't a good one, but the point is that there are those moments that that foster that identification, that foster that connection. And this movie shows us some of those moments, whether it's this one when we see him as a child and we can understand how hard that must have been and what that might have done to him, or when he first gets to the city and starts the paper and maybe we feel a bit of admiration for a sort of go-get him attitude and the way he wants to sort of upend the old order. But we're sort of seeing those at a distance, right? Because even though in the smaller moments we're not reminded of it, at the end of the day, we're hearing that told to us by someone else who's recalling something happening. And I think that the film is one of the film's great achievements is it makes things so difficult for itself in terms of narrative flow and character identification, but it still succeeds in those things, I think, to a considerable degree, if not entirely. And that's one of the reasons I think it's so interesting.
Right. Thank you.
Andrew, there was a question in the chat asking about editing. What about the editing as a kind of technique? I know that, I don't know if editing is something you're going to be focusing on in one of the other topics, but just to bring that in.
Yeah, this movie was edited by Robert Wise, who would go on to be quite a successful director in his own right, directing, among other movies, The Sound of Music, and also Star Trek The Motion Picture. So something to admire and maybe something not to admire so much. But no, he would have a long career as a filmmaker, as a director in his own right. And I think that, I mean, a movie that has as many changes in time, as many layers to its story, someone trying to find people who can tell them about this other person who's already dead and things that happened decades ago, editing is going to be very important because, you know, one of the reasons that a lot of audiences have trouble recognizing why Citizen Kane has the reputation it has is that so many things in it that were innovative or even revolutionary at the time it came out have become standard practice. One of those being the nonlinear narrative. Now, was it the first Hollywood movie to do that? No, it wasn't the first Hollywood movie to do that. But did it do it to an unbelievable degree? Did it weave a complex sort of chronological line like hadn't been seen before and would rarely be seen again? Yeah, it did. And the fact that this movie isn't interested in making, in trying to be easy is one of the things that really sets it apart. And the editing is an essential element of that. And there are things that, there's a famous scene, I don't have the clip lined up, but there's the scene of Kane and his wife at breakfast. And we sort of see this breakfast that goes on for years and years, the sort of back and forth between them. And that's an example where editing is obviously key, but editing in and of itself isn't really enough to do that. I mean, that enough to sort of sell that montage. It works. Certainly the editing is important in terms of the pacing and the timing and when the cuts happen based with regard to what someone is saying or the reaction someone's giving someone else. But that also doesn't work without the props and set, the costume, the makeup, the performances, and for that matter, the dialogues. People will think what I tell them to think. I mean, that's a great biting line that we can all imagine someone like Kane saying. And so, there aren't too many examples in this movie where the editing is something noteworthy in and of itself, but by the standards of the day, certainly it would have been a very demanding film from an editing point of view.
Thank you. Doug?
Hi. I was intrigued by the point about character and how this film can be, you don't feel particularly empathetic towards the main character. Sure. For a lot of reasons, but I think that is also supported by depth of field. And I'd be curious your take on this, because the conventional Hollywood movie, it seems to me, the camera follows the star and frames it so that you see the star, usually in a nice medium shot where they can fill it out and it's not too ostentatious. And it's all about seeing the star do things. This movie, and I think through the depth of field, shows the character in surroundings, in a very very conscious composition, so that whereas in a conventional movie where the star is always right in the center of the frame and we have a chance to really bond with that person and we're kind of drawn to it, and maybe even the background is blurred out so that they look a little hazy in the back and it gives you that real romantic look. Here, Kane is always very much another piece of the set dressing, whether he is dominating a scene like we saw in some of those, some of the theater shots or whatever, or when he's in the newspaper office and he's just so titanic, or if he's being literally swallowed up by that fireplace. He's always within the environment. And so we don't have that same intimate connection that we would in the normal Hollywood movie. I was just wondering your take on your reaction on that.
Well, I think you're right. I mean, that's certainly a way that this, but that's certainly a way this movie is different than other movies. But again, that's by design. I mean, we're not supposed to like him and we're not supposed to know him. The whole movie is about getting to know him. And, you know, at the end of the day, I think part of the point of the film is that, you know, you never really know someone like that. And everything you're sort of trying to piece together, you're doing at a distance and with limited information. And that's sort of the nature of public figures. But you're absolutely right. I mean, the point is to show, I mean, I think what Kevin said in the chat, show him in his context, in his milieu, and how he is a character of those environments, whether he created the environment or whether he's coming in to dominate someone else's environment. He's not a person the way the rest of us or the rest of the people in the movie are people, right? We see, you know, he, this, the scenes of him, the shots of him are very different than most of the other people, unless someone's in a scene with him. But think about the other times we see, think about the shots we see Jedediah by himself. Think about the shots where we see Susan by herself, right? There's none of that sort of same iconography that we see with him. And that's because they are different. You know, they are, you know, planetoids circling the star, orbiting the star that is Charles Foster Kane. And you can't get that close, you can't get close enough to a star to be able to know it the same way you can these other bodies. And I think that's part of the point.
Andrew, I know we're just at 8:30. I see two more hands. Do you have time for two more questions?
Sure.
Great. Daniel?
Thanks. Andrew, it's not really about cinematography, but I recall from reading or a class I've had on Citizen Kane about the company RKO and that being a significant company through the production. It just occurred to me to ask if you had any insight into, I guess, RKO in the studio system and maybe how some of the production informed the movie in general.
Well, RKO wasn't one of the bigger studios at the time. It wouldn't survive as an independent entity for much more than 10 years after this movie comes out. You know, but it's very often the small and scrappy and perhaps underdog company that takes the big gamble, right? The Warner Brothers were the ones who brought the jazz singer and sound to Hollywood initially, to narrative features anyway. And they didn't do that because they were in a dominant position. They did that because they weren't in a dominant position, and they needed what we would today call a game changer. And I think RKO sort of was in a similar sort of mindset when they went and got, you know, I mean, they gave him a deal. You know, we think about deals now and how, you know, stars get deals and these great writers get deals, or the guy who wrote The Martian, you know, got this deal for his screenplay. It's just this sort of self-published story he wrote. But that, you know, so today, this doesn't seem that unusual that someone, you know, Julie Taymor, who was known for Broadway, got to make movies. That doesn't seem like such a big deal. But at this time, when Hollywood is extremely reluctant to give individual credit to people, and certainly anyone who was a star at that time was a star that you recognized and they were on the screen and there was value to them being a star. The fact that this guy got to sort of write his own ticket. It was a short ticket and he didn't have as much freedom as he thought he did. But the fact that he got that when he was 26 years old, he'd never had done anything having to do with movies before. And he got this, that's not the act of a studio that is comfortable in its position. That's just not how Hollywood worked at that time. It would be how it would work in the 70s and since then, but not at that time when it's very much an industry town. The other thing about being significant about RKO is it may have been the only studio, if not the only studio, then it was one of the very, very few studios that was not run or owned by Jewish people. And the reason this would come to be an issue is because Hearst was an anti-Semite, and Hearst, when he became aware of this movie, he wanted to try to stop it from ever coming out. And he didn't go to RKO and threaten them because he didn't really have anything to threaten them with. He instead went to Louis B. Mayer and threatened to out Mayer and Zukor at Paramount and Cohn at Columbia and some of the others, not Walt Disney, obviously, as Jews, which in America in 1940 would have been a big deal. People who knew the business, people who worked in the industry certainly were aware that these people were Jewish, but the vast majority of Americans who went to the movies and who were the bread and butter with their weekly attendance at motion pictures didn't. And I, as a Jewish person myself, I'm not interested in thinking that knowing they were Jewish would have devastated the industry. But what really matters is those men were afraid it would devastate their industry. And the story goes that Hearst basically said to Louis B. Mayer, I don't want this movie to come out. What are you going to do about it? And Mayer said, I would sue him. What do you want me to do? And he basically says to him, you know, if you guys don't stop this movie from coming out, I'm going to tell the world that you're all Jews. I'm going to tell America that you're all Jews in my newspapers. And so they put together a fund of something like $800,000 and went to the RKO board and said, we will pay you $800,000 for the negative to Citizen Kane. And apparently they thought about it. But supposedly Welles and George Schaefer, who was the head of RKO, talked them out of doing that. But that was what the plan Mayer came up with. And it was, it wasn't dismissed out of hand. Apparently there was some consideration, because you have to imagine these people who run the company and fund RKO see this movie that is in many ways like no other movie they've seen and is, for lack of a better term, challenging to the viewer. So they can't imagine, you know, the bird in hand is worth more than the speculation of what the movie could do again in a movie that challenging. $800,000 is a lot of money. So that's one huge reason why that it was RKO was very successful. If it had been at another, I mean, none of those successful studio people would have given Welles the deal and would have let him make that movie. They wouldn't have. So in a way it's sort of moot, but if it had been another one of those studios, I don't think we'd be able to watch the movie today.
Thanks so much. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah, great question. And thanks for all that detail, Andrew. And Kevin?
Okay, well, I just have two quick things. The first one is a comment on identification, and the other one is just an observation on the composition of the shot we saw in the scene earlier. So on identification, when I watch this movie, I don't feel like, I feel like I'm observing scenes in Kane's life and not merging with the character through identification. Like, I don't feel like identification is really the point. You're just kind of observing, you know? And then on composition, what I saw in that shot earlier is like, in the background, you see Kane framed by a window, and then in the middle, you see the father framed by like the entryway between rooms. And then in the foreground, you see the mother signing the contract. So I guess if I do have a question, I would say, is that meant to like illustrate like the degrees of separation between them all?
Yeah, I mean, one of the, you know, the bigger something is on screen, the more sort of importance we're supposed to attribute to it. The closer something is to the camera, the more importance we're supposed to attribute to it. That's why a close-up is a way to sort of emphasize something, because it makes the thing big and close. And so the fact that as you get farther away from the camera, so the most important person in the front, I mean, I can do this just really quickly right here. So the most important person is the biggest and closest, Mrs. Kane. She's clearly calling all the shots. Sort of second most important and her sort of ally is Thatcher. The father is of varying importance to the scene and the scenario and the events, and he's sort of moving back and forth in the middle ground. The one who's the least important is the boy, and you talk about barriers. The boy isn't even in the room. He's not even in the building. There's a wall between him. He's the furthest out of the loop. But you're absolutely right that the father is sort of in this, you know, in this doorway. There's some physical separation there with the set, in addition to the distance that decreases and increases depending on how much he's asserting, or I should say insinuating himself into the discussion. So yes, I think it's absolutely intentional to, again, to remind us or give us this reinforcement visually of what the sort of the dialogue and the story is telling us.
Well, thank you, Andrew, for all of these insights into this film and giving us this first foundation of tools to appreciate future films. And thank you, everyone, for such great questions and really for a wonderful conversation tonight. I look forward to seeing you all in a couple weeks when we get to discuss Hitchcock's The Birds, also fitting for October. And I know that there'll be a lot to unpack in that one too, as Hitchcock, has a lot of tricks up his sleeve. Any final words, Andrew, to send us out?
No, just thanks everyone for thinking of this film, certainly thematically, which it is very rich in that regard, but for also letting me talk to you a little bit about some of the technical choices that I think are also part of the reason it's so interesting.
Good night, everybody. Thank you.
Bye.
See you in a couple weeks.